tithe and bring your shame. Bring your guilt and bring your pain. Don't you know that's not your name? You will always be much more to me. And every day I wrestle with the voices that keep telling me I'm not right. But that's all right, 'cause I hear a voice and it calls me redeemed. When others say I'll never be enough, and greater is the one living inside of me than he who is living in the world. In the world. In the world. And greater is the one living inside of me than he who is living in the world.
Bring your doubts, bring your fears, bring your hurt.
Good evening. Welcome to our Monday evening program. I do have some announcements to share. I'll go through some of these other ones first. The reminder that laundry is not free. Please come to the registration office for instructions. You can do laundry, but we need to talk it through with you if you're going to do that. So please come to registration and they'll explain it. The women's banquet will be at 5 o'clock in the dining commons on Wednesday. Today is the last day to get tickets. Those that will not be attending the youth banquet or the women's banquet, be it man, woman, or child, will be meeting Wednesday under the tent for a barbecue where the food will be served. So if you're not going to the women's banquet, and you're not off campus for the youth banquet, you're going to be under the tent to eat here on campus for dinner. These are all, as you can see, brand new announcements. We use the old-fashioned cut-and-paste type of circulating information. No, I don't want to steal his act. All parents and sponsors of junior and senior high youth need to fill out the online waiver for Sky Zone by tonight if they will be attending. Should you have any questions on this, please see Debbie Bond. So if you have junior or senior high youth and the activity is to go to Sky Zone, they have to fill out an online waiver by tonight. Again, see Debbie Bond for details on that. As a reminder, curfew is midnight. You must be in your dorm. The fob will stop working. You won't get back in. So, midnight curfew, must be in your dorm. A lost key for the Days Inn has been found, and it's at registration. If you want to stop by the registration office, if you're staying at Days Inn but can't get in. A reminder that people are not allowed to sleep in the common area of the suites, for those that are over in the suites, on the furniture or on the floor. We're not allowed to have anybody in the common area. You must be in one of the rooms with the beds. If you're on the floor in there, you already can't be out in the common area. So, those are the announcements I was handed. We have had a glorious new opportunity in our schedule. Due to unforeseen circumstances, we have to move the women's basketball game and the youth versus pastors basketball game to this evening. Appropriate time to groan. Thank you. Unfortunately, they have to close the gym after tonight. So we will be playing those basketball games this evening following worship. As soon as you can get over there, because I'm sure most of the pastors did not wear their basketball gear here. Most. Not scared at all. You hear that, youth? So because of this, Because basketball is being moved to tonight, the young adult afterglow and Bible study will be moved to Wednesday night. We will also need to move the preliminaries for church family feud and the Bible quiz to Tuesday, Wednesday instead of Monday, Tuesday. So, needless to say, the big change, basketball games tonight, the youth versus our ladies. We still have plenty of opportunities on the roster. Everybody's counting on you, not to put any pressure on you, but we'll start naming names tomorrow for those that fail to show. We'll be doing that as soon as we can after the evening worship service. If the pastors and pastors' wives want to go through and just carb up on all the snacks and everything, I'm sure that'd be fine by the youth. But come on out there as quick as you can. We will be in the gymnasium. We're going to try to get the seats over there. The reason we can't play Wednesday like we originally scheduled is they are replacing their bleachers, and they started this week, so we don't have bleachers. So we're trying to get some chairs over there. If you do come over, there'll be a limited number of chairs. Please allow those that might need the chairs more than you to have the chairs while you're out in the basketball court. So if you have any questions on that, please see me. But we're trying to do our best to roll with the flow here. There will be some changes on the activities, the youth activities for Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. We will update you on that as we clarify them. But tonight, the youth activity is going to be coming out to the basketball game. So any questions? Good. With that, I'd like to invite the choir forward.
Hallelujah. You know, we've been talking about being steadfast, and you know God has been steadfast in our lives, amen? He's always there, you know, and this year God has just proven himself, you know, over and over and over again. And what a better way to say thank you than just to praise him and to give him worship, amen? So if you don't mind, if you can stand with us as we just lift up praises to our Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Bass. For him and him alone, amen? Amen. Glory to you, God. Thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. bless you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, we worship you, Lord. Hallelujah, glory to your name. There's none like you, O Lord, none worthy but you, Father. Hallelujah.
Came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh, the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living, he loved me, dying, he saved me.
say hallelujah, Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. You know, this next song we're singing, it's few words, but it's powerful. So for those of us that might be going through something, I don't know, maybe something in our bodies, something in relationships, whatever it may be, there's power in the name of Jesus to break every chain, to break every stronghold, to tear down whatever is standing against us. Hallelujah. The name of Jesus is powerful. Hallelujah, Lord. And we thank you tonight, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus.
For breaking the chains, Lord God. Blessed be your name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
anything we can give by your plans. That's just the way it is.
We're going to sing this last song together. Hallelujah. Worship you. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just let go of everything. You know, I love singing these little songs to the Lord. It's just like singing a love song to him. Hallelujah. It's just you and him. Hallelujah, Lord. Only you are whole. Only you are worthy. Only you, Lord. And only you are wonderful. For there's no one
We're so thankful, Father, that you welcome us into your holy presence, oh Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, only you are holy. Only you are worthy of glory and honor, Lord. Only you are wonderful, Lord. And Father, we want our life to be a living testimony, oh God, of Jesus Christ, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Father, we pray tonight, as Pastor Chroniger come, Lord, that you would just surround him, Father God. Fill him, Lord. Flow over him, oh God. Use him, Father, for your glory and honor, oh Lord. And I pray, Father, tonight that all our hearts will be fixed on you, oh God. Hallelujah. That we look for nothing else in the sanctuary but you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Only you, oh God, and you crucified. We bless you. We honor you. And we give you all the glory in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, Savior, and soon coming King. Amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Washington, D.C. Praise Band. Many of you, well, some of you were not in earlier. I just need to update something real quick for an announcement. This evening's activities have been shifted around. The basketball games, the women's game, and the youth versus pastors that was scheduled for Wednesday night will actually be tonight following the service because we cannot use the gym after this evening. So that's been moved to now. I also forgot to mention earlier, the conference crier is back and it is online. It's online is where you'll find it at conferencecrier.com. So check that out. Thank you very much.
First scripture I'll be reading tonight is from Colossians chapter 3, starting at verse 1. I'll be reading from the New American Standard. Therefore, if you have been raised up with Christ, keep seeking the things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the things above, not on the things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. First song we'll be singing is How Great Thou Art.
How great thou art, let us stand.
I hear the
I'll be reading from Romans 12, the first two verses, from the Message. So here's what I want you to do, God helping you. Take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Embracing what God does for you is the best thing you can do for Him. Don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what He wants from you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you, develops well-formed maturity in you.
I'm convinced that if we would just realize how much God loves us, we'd be changed by that. Get it? That's the point, right? We very much over our period of time, quite frankly, it's been over a year or so, the Lord's been bringing back to me this thing about identity and finding ourselves in Christ Jesus, that we, if we have come to Him in faith, and we recognize what Jesus did on the cross, that His blood shed for every human being on this planet. And He didn't wait around for human beings to say, well, I love you, back. I used to think, and read, for God so loved the world, meaning all the good people that Jesus died for, right? For God so loved the good people. You know, those who go to church. Those that read their Bible. Those that go to different, whatever. And it's only those good people that, and yet, think about it. God so loved the world. Who's in that world? Who is it? That's every human being on this planet. Everyone who's been affected by sin, by Adam's and Eve's disobedience. And that's everyone. And yet God says, by the blood of Jesus Christ, the price that's paid for every human being on this planet, regardless of whether they're whatever, it says that every human being is worth the blood of the Son. Every human being. So what do we do in our lives? God says you were worthy of the price of Jesus. Now, we know what it means when you buy something in the store or you purchase something, right? You know that what you're paying for is worth the price. See where I'm going? God the Father says of you that you're worth the price, an awesome price, regardless of what your circumstances are or what your past was or whatever you throw up there. I love you, God says, and you'll say, but? You just don't know me. You don't know where I've been, or how I was treated, or words that have spoken to me. You know, what offenses I've come up against.
God says, I don't care. I love you anyway. Jesus' blood was shed. And he says, I love you. The apostle Paul, the apostle in Philippians, and I invite you to join with me there. And he brings up some things concerning himself and his manner of life of the past. And maybe this will help a little bit of those of you that are doing the contest in Philippians. I don't know. But Philippians chapter 3. We find that in Philippi, Paul is in prison at this point. He's writing to Philippi, and he says there are people in there, guys that he calls them super apostles, you know, sarcastically speaking. Oh, these are the ones that say, well, I'm a good practicing Jew, but I'm also a Christian. I'm a follower of Jesus, but you got to do all these things and in order to follow the Lord, you have to follow the law. And the apostle in chapter 3 calls them some not so nice things and says, he tells them this in verse 2. He says, watch out for those dogs, those men who do evil, those mutilators of flesh. For it is we who are the circumcision, we are the who worship in the Spirit of God, who glory in Christ Jesus. Notice, in Christ Jesus, who put no confidence in the flesh, though I myself have reason for such confidence. Now he's going to go and say some things that he possibly could have confidence in. And I don't know, maybe as you sit here and you hear this list from the apostle, you might say, well, yeah, I've got pride in that. Yeah, this is great. This is wonderful. For instance, let's do this. It says, if anyone else thinks that he has reason to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day. What's that tell us? Well, he was raised in a religious home. In fact, they were pretty obedient to the law. Yes, the eighth day, that's what you do when a baby's born. The eighth day, you're circumcised. That's the practice. You're very obedient to the law. So Paul says, I could be proud of that. Another one. He goes, I'm of the people of Israel. I'm of the right nation. Man, I was born in Israel. You know, we were born in America. Song, eh? Pretty proud of that, right? Great. Wicked. He says, I'm of Israel. I'm of the eighth day. Okay, what else? He says, I'm of the tribe of Benjamin. Now, Benjamin sometimes was looked upon, that tribe was looked upon, but Paul is saying, I'm of the right tribe. Because Benjamin, what Benjamin did when the split in Israel between north and south, Benjamin was one of those that hung out closer to the temple in the south. Pretty proud of that. After all, I'm not one of those people that lived on the wrong side of the tracks. Right? He's pretty proud of that. I'm of the right tribe. I'm a Hebrew of the Hebrews. I mean, he knows the language. He's got it down. I'm outstanding. I do everything. I know the little intricacies of how to practice. I know. He says, in regard to the law. Now, this is very important because he says, I'm a Pharisee. Do you know Pharisees? You've heard of Pharisees? These are people who practice things. And in fact, the Pharisees were the type of people that they didn't want to get real close to breaking the law. So they set up other laws, right? They kind of like they set up fences along the way to keep them from violating the major law. And Jesus had something to say about that, didn't he? He says, you're inventing the things of man, the traditions of man to break the commandment of God. But they set these fences up thinking that all these little details so that I could be pretty religious on the outwardly. And then putting burdens on everybody else so they cannot. He's pretty proud of it. And how proud Paul was of this, look at this. He says, as for zeal persecuting the church. Wow, I'm going to get those heretics. I'm going to get those guys. I mean, come on, you know, they're not pure. We need to get rid of them. As for legalistic righteousness, faultless. You see, there's a lot of things in our lives, and I spoke of that earlier, things that happen to us. I know there are people in, as we get older, I know of people who just think that they've lost their identity in their health, and they become their health. They think because I couldn't do or can't do what I used to be able to do, and now I'm worthless because I can't do it. I venture would think that there are some out here like that. When I was younger, and growing up in elementary school, I don't know if this thing's going to work. I would read things backwards. Okay, I would had to go to the doctor and learn how to train my eyes to read properly. Here's the thing about that. Consequently, for me, education was something that was hard. It takes me longer to comprehend things. I have to read more than one time, and I just could not comprehend. And so education wasn't. So consequently, I'm thankful for music in high school, because that's the thing that kept me going on, because that was my thing. I wasn't going to go to college and end up going to college because education was tough. But I took my identity from my, whatever you want to call it, disability or whatever. And I thought of myself as being stupid and dumb. I'm sharing this. And the reason I'm sharing this is because I know that's not how Jesus looks at me. You got it? That's not how Jesus looks at you. Why? The cross. And the blood was shed. Paul goes on, he lists all these things. And he says, I could be proud of these things. This is me. This is my identity. I'm at the right family. I got the right tribe. I'm of the right nation. I'm religious. I've got it all together. I'm flawless in the way I practice. Let me lay this one on you. So will Paul. But whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in Him. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. I want to know Christ. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings. Being like him in his death, and so somehow to attain the resurrection from the dead. All these things that he wrapped up his own identity in the past, until the time he met Jesus on that road to Damascus, everything changed in that moment. And if anybody you can recognize changed, it was the Apostle Paul. He wasn't an apostle then. But meeting Jesus changes the heart. You see, this is what I truly believe about going to heaven, that when Jesus died on the cross, it wasn't just for the forgiveness of sins. Can I keep on going? It wasn't just for the forgiveness of sins. It was to transform our heart. It's to change us from the inside out. To be different people, from darkness to light. Old past, new things have come. Because Jesus comes in and he comes into our life. He comes in and changes us. He changes our heart. And let me say, I'm not talking about adding on a room to your heart. Renovating it, you know, the fixer-upper. That's not what Jesus does on the cross. We get a heart transplant. That's the truth. He replaces a hard heart with one that's pliable, that receives and knows the Lord and desires to know him in relationship. Finally, Bill, conclusion? Okay. So we go through our life, you've come to Jesus, two things. You've come to Jesus, and what if you sin, or you do something that did before you met Jesus? What do? You confess, but it's a totally different thought here. Let me point this out. You see, before you met Jesus, you didn't care, right? You didn't care what sin you did or whatever you did. It didn't matter. After you meet Jesus, man, I don't want to do that anymore. I hate that thing. And what God does through the cross in that moment, he's purifying your heart. He's transforming you. He's retraining you from the old Adam, the way the Adam thought, the old one, to the new Adam. Yeah, we confess. What do we confess? Thank you that you've made me a son or daughter of yours. Thank you for showing me that and giving me the power of pointing that out to me. This is different. This is a really genuinely admitting that you, what God already knows. But he wouldn't do that. That work of the Holy Spirit would not be happening in your life if it wasn't his. If you weren't his child, the scripture says, he wouldn't give you a chastisement. It wouldn't bother you at all. You wouldn't have any conviction whatsoever. And because you have a conviction about what you've done in sin, whatever, like you did in the past, the old nature, by the way, it's crucified on the cross. We come to him. Thank him for you. He has come into your life by his Spirit, and now Jesus is at work living through your life. It's not about the past. It's not about those things we throw up at all. I'm wondering, where do you draw your identity? If you looked in the mirror, what do you see? If you look in a mirror, what do you see? Do you see yourself as a son or daughter in God's family? Do you see yourself as one that's chosen before the foundation of the world to be in Jesus? Do you see yourself adopted into the family? When you look in that mirror? When you're adopted, what changes? You get a new name? New economic system, maybe? Right? You got a family. Changes. Changes. Quite frankly, when you look in the mirror, you should be able to see Jesus. Right? In you. Do you do that? You look in a mirror and see Jesus in you? That he promised to be there? That's different, isn't it? Totally different way of thinking. And it's truth. It's truth. I'm going to ask if you bow our heads at this point. I'm going to ask at this point to think about what was shared. Talk to Jesus. And thank him. What Jesus did on the cross. And if you have never, and at this point ever, told God that you love him, that he's your heavenly father, tell him that from your heart tonight. I love you, Father.
Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you that our identity is in you. We thank you that Jesus died and so that we could be called sons and daughters. Father, we thank you that we are no longer the things this world tries to peg us as. But it's not our job. It's not how much money we make. It's not who we know. We are your children. And you love us. Father, you love us so much. You want to wrap your arms around us and hold us and tell us that every day. Because that is who we are. It's not the sins we commit. It's what you've done. It's who you've made us. Sons, daughters, your children.
thank you, Father, and we praise you. Because that is a good gift.
Father, there are times we make it so hard to believe you and trust you. We think we have to do something in order just to believe. We know it's all of your grace. We hear your word that it says you never leave us or forsake us. You have given us your spirit, and we are your temple of your spirit. And Lord, so often we think we have to do something in order to make that happen. Help us just to believe your word. That you are present in our life. That you are changing us. And making us and causing us to be more like Jesus, your Son. So, Lord, I pray for those that are struggling in this area of their life. And help them to hear you speak in their heart your love. That they would receive your love through the blood and the sacrifice of Jesus, and that he died, buried, and rose again, so we who were dead in our trespasses and sin are raised to newness of life. For this we thank you, Lord. You mold us, you make us. We are the clay. And you're the potter. We give you praise and adoration. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand as we sing The Potter's Hand.
Savior, I know for sure
complete, without blame at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful is he who calls you, and he also will bring it to pass. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Attention, excuse me. Young adults, guys, we just, I have an announcement to make, so excuse me. Young adults, we just talked about how our identity as sons and daughters of God, the Young Adult Interest Committee will be held. We were aiming for 10. If the basketball game stretches longer than 10, then we're going to aim for as soon as after 10 as possible. But anyway, the Young Adult Interest Committee meeting will be held in the basement of Peterson. And for the rest of you guys, enjoy the rest of your night as sons and daughters of God. Thank you.